Hello, this is the Bingley Five Rise Lock Flight, and it's 250 years old today as I film this. It is also the steepest lock flight in the UK, going up just over 59 feet over a distance of 320 feet. That is a gradient of 1 in 5.
It's called the Five Rise because it's five canal locks built as one single structure. The steepness of the incline and the sheer size of the lock gates and mechanisms make this an astonishing achievement for 250 years ago. That's 1774, if your maths isn't up to it.
Because this is such an engineering marvel, it's been ascribed as a Grade 1 listed asset by Historic England. That puts it within the top 2.5% of heritage assets in the country, on a par with York Minster and Buckingham Palace. Now, the amazing thing about the Five Rise is it hasn't altered much in its 250 year history, and it is still as operational today as it was back then. It's mind-boggling to think of it. At the time, the local newspaper described it as an engineering marvel unparalleled of its type in the universe. There would have been teams of navvies who constructed this of local stone and local timbers. It's an absolute marvel how they achieved that without the technology that we have today, and quite honestly, I don't think we'd manage to do it today.
And if you imagine that every stone here was fashioned by hand, brought here by hand, fitted, shaped by hand, the gates themselves probably weigh 3 or 4 tons. It's a terrific endeavour, and to think that somebody did that in 1774 is just amazing.
I think it would have been a significant challenge. I mean, I think the one thing that they had to their advantage was that labour was not as costly as it is today. The laws, environmental laws, the safety laws, were not like they are today. So they had that in their favour, but the reality was their technology was a lot different from ours. Whenever I'm looking at the letters from the days when they were building the canals 200 years ago, I'm amazed how they managed to achieve anything without a mobile phone. They were dealing with letters, okay, and they sent a letter to the engineer and they might have got a reply 2 weeks later. So I'm always amazed at how they achieved it. Technology was different. They didn't have the cranes to lift the heavy stone that we have. These lock gates weigh about 6 tons and they didn't have a crane to lift that. They were using tripods. So it was all muscle and hard work.
The lock flight was a critical part of the Leeds and Liverpool Canal, which, like all British canals, made the Industrial Revolution possible, transforming the manufacture and distribution of goods around the country and out to the world.
Prior to the canals, the only real inland transport links were by rivers, which couldn't be very navigable sometimes, and also by horses. Now, you couldn't transport much by horse, so the wealthy merchants of the Air Valleys thought, let's build an inland link where we can get to all our resources.
They promoted the canal and started building it in 1770. And they started in two locations, actually. They started over in Lancashire, near Ormskirk. And on the 2nd of December 1770, they started building it in Skipton towards Leeds. After 3 years, so 1773, they opened the first section between Skipton and Bingley, and then 250 years ago today, they opened the section we're on today from the Bingley Five Rise down towards Shipley and towards Field Lock, about 3 miles down from here. At the time, the newspaper, the Leeds Intelligencer, described this section of canal as having some of the noblest works in the universe.
A quarter of a millennia later, and boats are still able to travel up and down the flight as they progress along the 127-mile Leeds and Liverpool Canal. But the decades of use takes its toll.
As with any historic building, it does show signs of its age, and it's part of a working heritage that's been continuously in operation since its time of construction. So it's been built in 1773, opened in 1774, and since then it's been absolutely hammered. And the best way to keep them in operation is to keep them in use, and if possible, in use in line with their original purpose. We find that although the fabric is pretty much as it was in its original construction, that there are things that need constant targeted renewal and replacement. So where we've got bits of brickwork or masonry, stone masonry in this case, we'll do sensitive repairs in line with traditional craft skills. We'll also use lime mortar, which was the original mortar that would have been used for pointing up. But we do introduce modern engineering techniques where we know that we've got leakage through the lock chambers as well.
What we always try and aim to do is use sympathetic materials, sympathetic construction techniques, so we are maintaining that significance. And by giving it the occasional lick of paint, fixing bits, we are enhancing the asset for all to enjoy. We use the traditional materials, local quarried stone. Our canal gates are made of oak. We make them in-house at Stanley Ferry, which is just outside of Wakefield. And we do the best we can to keep this canal going.
Because of the way they're constructed, you have to approach staircase locks slightly differently to an individual lock or even a flight of individual locks. You see, on a staircase, each chamber is directly connected to the next. So, for example, to go down, you want the top chamber full and all the ones below it to be empty, because the top chamber will empty into the next, which will empty into the next. Equally, going up, you want all the chambers full except the bottom one, because then that penultimate chamber will empty into the bottom one, you move into it, and then the next one up empties into that, you move into it, and so on and so forth. So getting all the locks set before you go down or up is absolutely critical.
Reality is that even when it was built, it was old technology. And the reason for that is that a staircase lock uses a lot more water than a flight of locks. And so from a water use perspective, it was quite inefficient.
When there's plenty of rain, the high water use isn't such an issue. But in dry summers, it's a different story. Last year, the canal was closed to boats for a substantial part of the season because there wasn't enough water to keep it running. In part because of this, and to make passage more efficient, the Canal and River Trust operates a scheduling system where 2 hours each morning are for boats going down, then 2 hours up, and the same again in the afternoons. Passage isn't permitted outside those times.
When we take boats down, you can imagine that each chamber ends up being empty by the time the boat's got to the bottom. Then, if we were to bring boats up, each of the four chambers has to be filled so that every chamber ahead of the boat is full. To do that, if you bear in mind that each chamber holds about 90,000 gallons, to turn the locks round to up consumes about 1 million litres.
As well as supply problems, water leaks are unsurprising on a network that's over 200 years old. And chasing them down is a permanent headache for the Canal and River Trust.
If you think about the way the canal as a historic water management system works, we are trying to get water to go where it doesn't naturally want to go. And the materials that we used back in the day, although lime is a fantastic building material because it's self-healing, it's flexible, so with the extremes of environment that a canal can experience, water will find the smallest of gaps to go through, and once it opens up, it will start working away at that endlessly. We don't want to dismantle the lock and have to rebuild, because one, that is incredibly disruptive and not a necessary intervention where we have modern materials and techniques to help us. We would use grouting, and that was a principle that's established in the Victorian period, where you're consolidating the mass of material, which would have been a lime-bound rubble core, behind that facade of stone masonry. You're using the lime, which finds the voids left by leak paths. It's gradually wearing away the fines. We put some grout in there, and it helps to stem the leakage and stop it going through the structure.
Apart from maintaining an accurate heritage, another reason to be careful about what's used to fix the holes is the wildlife. Not something you might at first consider relevant inside a lock chamber.
If you pass through the locks, you notice all that stuff on the walls of the lock, And people don't tend to think of that as wildlife, but it's really important. You know, there's mosses on there, there's little shellfish as well. We've got little mussels that grow on the sides of locks, and the stuff in the bottom in the mud, there's always stuff in the mud, which is interesting for us ecologists, but it's all part of the ecosystem, those amazing complex network of species and habitats. The thing about canals is they're a really vital network of corridors for wildlife. They connect other wildlife sites. We've got Bingley Bog next to here, which is a lovely wetland. And we've got everything from high moorland along this canal all the way down to basically estuary when you get to the ends of it. Everything in between. And even the structures, as I said, create an amazing habitat. A lot of wildlife has had time to move in and create a home for themselves in our old buildings and locks and tunnels and all sorts.
So the canal today has shrugged off its industrial origins and offers a multitude of uses.
It forms a place for people to live, a place for people to have a holiday on and relax, to walk along the towpaths. It is a wildlife corridor. We have otters living in the Leeds-Liverpool Canal. We have kingfishers on it. But also it is a route of really important heritage.
You've got one of the most fascinating sections of early canal engineering. So either way you approach it, I would recommend coming from the Shipley end. So you transition through those kind of mill towns where you've got the former canal side warehouses and transshipment storage there, through into Saltaire, which is designated as a World Heritage Site. Then you come onto the crossing of the River Aire at Dowley Gap, where you'll approach Hurst Lock, which is the first single lock. Then you're coming across a massive embankment, which itself is remarkable in early engineering terms, cut through the hillside. You then launched onto a seven arch aqueduct that then you spring to a two rise at Dowley Gap, a three rise at Bingley, three rise and a five rise, and off you go, steady sailing now for 17 miles up to Skipton. It's an absolute joy.
It's a lovely place to be. If you just look around, we're in the open air, meet lots of lovely people, lots of lovely boaters, and it's an enjoyable experience. I suppose you've got to have a bit of a passion for the canal to truly enjoy that aspect. But one of the delights is bringing a boat up here, go through that chamber, and there's 200 people at the top, all looking at you. It's quite something.
Thanks for watching. Cheerio.